Hello, friends. Welcome to the last talk of today. I think you may be tired, so I'll try to be as coherent as possible. My name is Stanisław Chmiela, and I'm a software engineer at Software Mansion, which is a Kraków-based, well, not a software house, but a software mansion. We have many closed and open source projects under our belt. One of them is Expot, work on which I was invited about a year ago. At the beginning of the year, we've decided to start a process of transforming Expo. In this talk, I'd like to explain why did we do this and what we've ended up with today. But before we dive into details of what we call universal modules, let's ensure we all know what Expo is. Expo is a free and open source toolkit built around React Native. It jumpstarts mobile app development, providing a couple of convenient tools. During the development, you would probably use these three a lot. First of all, Expo SDK is a React Native library that gives you access to numerous high-quality APIs built into Expo. You may wonder how many. Well, I think quite a lot. I hope every one of you can find an API that you have already used or can imagine a legitimate use case for. We try to make it possible for developers to develop their apps without needing to detach for as long as possible. Second of all, there's Snug, an online code editor available at snug.expo.io. It's very useful when you want to create MVPs, proof of concepts, and examples of all sorts of your new great React Native component, or, for example, of potential bugs in Expo SDK. It's like a code sandbox for React Native. Lastly, there is Expo Client, a free application available on App Store and Play Store. It lets you quickly open any plain React Native project or an Expo-dependent application. What's more, it supports opening projects not only dependent on the latest version of Expo, but also on a couple of past versions. When you have your app ready to publish and distribute, you can use Expo CLI to bundle your JavaScript code and let Expo builders, codenamed Turtle, and the logo is not official yet, build application file. The good thing is, building doesn't have to happen on your machine. You don't need to install Android Studio to build Android apps, and you don't even have to have a Mac to develop an iOS application. In this example, building a standalone iOS application took only 3 minutes. Wait for it, and bam, here we have it. It's faster than in normal life. Then you have it. You have your IPA or IPK. You can put it on the App Store or Play Store and with zero configuration. Moreover, Expo lets you send push notifications to applications built by Expo, and it supports over-the-air updates, as Quinn explained earlier today. But let's go back to Expo SDK. The problem, it didn't look like this. It looked more like this. It was a rather big chunk of interdependent code that you either included or not. It was an unnecessary bloat for simple applications using only one or two of our APIs, and a pain point for contributors who wanted to contribute only one patch to a small module, and they had to clone our whole runtime and build it. Our dream was to make it more like this. A set of separate libraries you could customize. You'd be able to remove unneeded APIs, replace with your custom ones, or even add your own. So, at the beginning of the year, we set out to transform Expo SDK in a way that would let you customize builds done by Turtle and let you remove unneeded APIs from your applications, that would make the SDK more like an open ecosystem to which everyone would be able to contribute to, and also that wouldn't swell your app unnecessarily. As a side quest, we've decided to strip out React Native references from our APIs and make them platform agnostic. So after the migration, one could use our modules not only in React Native applications, but also, for example, in Flutter as well. To help us visualize the way the code works, let's pick an example. One of the first contributions I've made to Expo, which I'm quite fond of, was the face detector module. Although it is a fun module, like it can put Expo bow ties onto people, it's not really used for most applications. So we've decided to use it as the example on which we'll test the new architecture. Let's dive into how code providing such features is designed underneath. So everything starts with the camera component. It requires two other modules: permissions module to check whether it can access the device's camera, and face detector to detect faces. To be able to split Expo, we don't want to import these modules directly. We would like you to be able to swap out the implementation of your custom one, or even remove the face detector altogether. In fact, camera should compile even without the permissions module. How have we approached such requirement? We inspected how camera uses the face detector and extracted an interface, which we then implemented in the face detector. Now camera can use face detector and not import this specific implementation. In fact, we did the same with the permissions module. So now camera can work and compile without implementations of these interfaces, handling such cases on its own. Now that we have this new artifact, where should we put it? Putting it into the Expo face detectors package wouldn't make much sense, since camera would have to depend on this exact package, and that's what we want to get rid of. Letting consumer define that interface was one of the earliest ideas we had. Camera would ask, hey, give me face detector module implementing this interface. Then some manager would check whether the face detector it knows really implements this interface by reflection and downcasting. It would be possible to make it work, but it wouldn't be neither easy to maintain nor helpful for developers of these modules. So we've decided to put the interface into its own well-known package. This way, anyone can write a module that Expo Camera would be able to use as the face detector. Just implement the interface. In fact, this is the general idea that stands behind this whole universal modules transformation. But that's not all, folks. Let me guide you through some of the implementation details, so when you write your next Expo module or use one, you know how does it work under the hood. So backtracking to this slide. Classes that provide implementation of interfaces are called internal modules. In this case, those two red blocks represent classes implementing those interfaces. It's very easy to register a class as an implementation of an interface. Just implement exported interfaces method and return an interface there. By the way, the code samples are from iOS implementation. The Android side, it looks very similar. There is another type of module visible on this diagram. Camera is a view manager, and view managers, yeah, just they manage views, just as they do in plain React Native. One of the features of Expo Face Detector is that it not only lets you detect faces on the camera preview, but you can also order it to detect faces on an arbitrary image from the client code. If so, we need to be able to call from client code to the native side. For that, we've devised a concept of exported module. In this example, face detector module, being an exported module, exports some of its methods to client code. Exporting methods in a universal module is as easy as exporting methods in plain React Native. Just use simple macro on iOS or an annotation on Android. Sometimes you have some memory-heavy module, or you want to ensure that there will be only one instance of a given class for the whole lifetime of native application. This is the case, for example, with CM Motion Manager. As Apple documentation states, we should create only one instance of this class for our application. If we put managing it into an internal or exported module, we would probably create an instance of this class for every refresh of the JS application. If we put this in a static variable, we would only be able to use it from inside that module. In Expo Client, the need to have such a manager is even stronger, since we can run multiple JS apps, so-called experiences, side by side. To solve this issue, we've come up with a concept of a singleton module. They're created only once per application and are identified by a string. To recap what we've learned, there are four types of modules. First, internal modules implement some interfaces, create and are created only once per every React Native Bridge instance. Exported modules export methods to client code. Singleton modules are by definition created only once per lifetime of a native application, and view managers manage views. Let's see how those different roles together act together from a bigger perspective. First, when the native app launches, an instance of the Singleton module is created and saved. When a JS app is launched, permissions module is created. It is both an internal module implementing permissions interface and an exported module. It gains access to the sole instance of the permissions manager. When another JS app is launched or the same one is refreshed, another permissions module is created. It gains access to the same permissions manager. And since it registers itself as the provider of the permissions interface, Camera can access it just like that. You may wonder, how do all these modules connect to each other? All instances of modules are held in a special thing called module registry. It holds maps for all the different kinds of modules. For example, a mapping from an interface to its implementation. Every module that needs a reference to the module registry gets it once all the modules are properly registered. Then it can ask for other modules it needs. If there is no module implementing such interface, null will be returned, and Camera will handle this case as it sees fit. Presence and absence of different modules doesn't affect other modules. Grabbing an instance of, for example, an internal module implementing file system interface is as easy as calling one method and passing this interface as an argument. To sum up, module registry provides modules with other modules. It all sounds great, but you may wonder, what is the path from a universal module package to an all setup instance registered in the module registry? Let's start with the packages. In every package, there are obviously some classes defined. They all get registered in a single set of classes when they're loading. The set is governed by a module registry provider, which also manages instances of the singleton modules. It knows all the modules classes, so it can easily create new instances of those when creating new module registries. This is the purpose of a module registry provider. You may also wonder, how is it possible that one can call methods from Expo modules straight from React Native? Since we've removed all React Native references from the modules, we had to come up with some way of communication ourselves. For that, we've created a system of adapters. Expo Core, containing module registry, its provider, and interfaces for different types of modules, doesn't depend on any platform-specific feature. It's the React Native adapter that depends on both Expo Core and React Native. When React Native asks for extra native modules, adapter asks module registry provider for an instance of the module registry, which it then uses to create at least two React Native modules, a proxy that lets client code call into native, and some view managers. This is how React Native adapter works, but each adapter will probably work differently. We've successfully put together a Flutter adapter, which allowed us to call into exported modules without any problems, but we are not ready to release it yet. The way the proxy works in React Native adapter is it holds a reference to module registry. Since the proxy is a React module, it can export constants and methods to JS code. So that's what we do. The proxy grabs all the exported modules from the module registry and exports this configuration as a constant. This lets us create a convenient semi-proxy object containing function calls to the proxy under methods names, very similar to the native modules component of React Native. Then we just export one method to JS and use it to multiplex calls to Expo exported modules. This is how a client code calls into native. This new system of modules obviously has some advantages and disadvantages. One of the advantages is that it's relatively simple as of now. I hope watching this presentation gave you an idea how the universal modules architecture works, and I've only been talking for 14 minutes. Another advantage of this design is the customizability of the environment. The fact that we can include Camera in our application, and, oh, sorry. And okay. The fact that we can include camera and not include face detector is great. Also, we can mix and match the library's code and our own overrides. For example, in Expo client, we include the Expo constants dependency as a whole, but also we override the provided constants internal module with our own, so we can pass more information about the environment to the experiences running in Expo client. The fact that we can use the same native module for both React Native and Flutter is also a big win for both libraries, developers, and the users. Unfortunately, universal modules also has some disadvantages. First of all, where you previously you had to install only one big package, that is ExpoKit, now to include one API, you may need to install a series of packages, the core, the platform adapter, the feature package you want to add, and dependencies of its interfaces and those interfaces. We love to abstract this hassle away in Expo Turtle Builders. Another disadvantage of this idea is that JS to native calls go through two proxies, first via React Native proxy, and then via our own Expo Native Modules proxy. Another problem is that it's still in early stage. It proved working for our workflow, where we both know exactly how to link those modules and how to port existing APIs to the new architecture. There are no tools yet that would help either of these tasks. Linking has to be done by hand. Also, the simplicity of the core packages might block adding new features, but we at Expo haven't had such problem yet. We believe an interesting future lies before us. We still have plenty of work to do to help adopt this technology. First of all, we would like developers to be able to customize apps built by Turtle. Do not include specific parts of Expo native code that already has been transformed to a universal module. We would also like to create some handy tools and give it to you to help you work with this new architecture. Things like create Expo library or Expo link. We are also thinking of creating a tool that would generate FFI code in both native code and JS from, for example, Swagger definition. At last, we would like this ecosystem to spread over more platforms, not only React Native and Flutter, but also Lua, for example. This is a list of all the packages we are developing now as a part of the Universal Module ecosystem. There are actually 19 APIs that are already extracted from Expo Mono library and are able to use today. So this is how Universal Modules are now architectured. I hope next time you see a promise rejection from Expo saying file system internal module not found, you'll know exactly what happened and what you should do to make it work back again. If you have any questions, you can find me on Twitter at sjmila. Thank you and see you at the evening party.